we can address if we can organize together. And I think going back to this idea of social mobility, we all have an investment in maintaining Flushing as a area where people from the working class can become middle class Americans. And again, we need to really build alliances across ethnic groups, across religions, and regardless of how long you've been here, we all need basic city services, we need more city investments, and we need greater attention on the social needs that are not being addressed. And I'd like to put in a plug for some of the work that the Greater Flushing Chamber of Commerce has been doing. If you look at, one of the biggest complaints we've actually gotten was around language. You know, there's a perception that Flushing is only for certain ethnic groups, that the signage on businesses is only in one language. And actually that's a perception rather than a reality, because I've participated in surveys where if you actually look at each sign, more than 90% of those signs actually have English on them. I think the issue is that a lot of new business owners don't have the capacity or the knowledge to expand their services beyond their ethnic enclave. And so we have been working with some of our members, including Monroe College, to offer free English classes to business owners. You know, because I think there's a lack of skills that some immigrant entrepreneurs have when they first come to this country, not only language, but also what are the local expectations of businesses in terms of giving back to the community, of providing certain types of services and products that everyone wants. And I think in addition to the classes, we have also been working on business assistance programs where we provide information on how you create a business plan. How do you get financing for starting up a business? How do you develop marketing plans to grow your business? Those are things that I think help everyone, regardless of your ethnic or religious background. Like I said before, we've been a big advocate on trying to get investment by the city, most recently with the Flushing West redevelopment project, but also with other projects regarding street access, sidewalks, pedestrian access, trying to work with Flushing High School to help their students, even though they are no longer a neighborhood school, they're still in Flushing. So we need to embrace the students in Flushing High School, even though they may come from other neighborhoods. And lastly, we've been doing a lot of networking and community building, trying to build the community through events like Flushing Night Out, which is our first community night market. That is a night market that attracts local vendors that sell different types of foods, that allows anyone who wants to sell to the local community and test the market an opportunity to do that. We did a fantastic job last year at Flushing High School, and we're hoping to do it again this year. And then lastly, we are promoting the Lunar New Year. You know, a lot of people dismiss the Lunar New Year as an exotic holiday that is really only for Chinese people. And I have to push back and disagree. You know, Chinese, Koreans, and other Asian ethnic groups have been in this country as long as the Irish and the Italians. And yet, we consider Columbus Day and St. Patrick's Day as somehow American holidays compared to Lunar New Year. And I would say that the Lunar New Year is as American as apple pie as any of these other holidays. And so we've been trying to get non-Asian residents and community groups to participate and march in the parade. This year it's going to be February 4th, it's a Saturday. I welcome everyone here and outside to come join us in celebrating the diversity of our community. So thank you.
I guess I just want to maybe conclude, because I think we want to leave time for audience questions and participation, but just a quick thought. John, I think that you wanting to preserve Flushing as a neighborhood that promotes social mobility, that this is something that kind of, you know, brings all of the diverse populations of Flushing together in to seek social mobility, and that this is a neighborhood that provides that opportunity. And I guess that I feel like I agree that there needs to be, you know, much more cross-racial coalition building that happens here in Flushing. But my sense is that it's interesting because when I talk to my students, or when my students and I talk about what's happening in Flushing in terms of the kind of the changes that we see and the kinds of new development that happens, they're hesitant to call it gentrification. And they're hesitant to kind of identify that what's happening to some of the populations that can no longer afford to live in Flushing as displacement. And in part, I think it's because that gentrification is being driven by Chinese, and so it doesn't really fit kind of the typical image that we have of gentrification with the white hipsters or whatnot. But increasingly, we do see the kind of retail establishments, the kind of developments. They're catered to, yes, hipsters. They may be Asian hipsters, but they're still affluent Asians, and this is the essence of gentrification. So I think that maybe, and the other thing that I wanted to say is that I kind of looked at some Department of Labor data regarding wages for different industry sectors. And we know that in, you know, Flushing is often, you know, called a satellite Chinatown, which we know that it is not. We don't even know if Manhattan Chinatown is really even Chinatown anymore in terms of a working class Chinese community. But when I compared the wages of workers in Flushing businesses with those in Sunset Park, which is another very, you know, growing Chinese community with the reputation of being largely working class, I compare the wages of workers in Sunset Park and in Manhattan Chinatown in the sectors like food, which is a very large sector, an employer of immigrants. The wages for Flushing was the lowest among those three neighborhoods. So there is definitely inequality here in Flushing that needs to be addressed. It's not just a narrative of our successes. There is inequality. It might be less visible, but it is certainly, you know, something that needs to be acknowledged, talked about, and addressed.
Tarry, I just want to say that I totally agree with you in terms of the inequalities within Flushing. But I disagree that all Chinese people are responsible for that type of development. We have to be really specific when we talk about who's responsible. International capital, it's not something that we all have access to. There are some people who have access to that capital, and I believe that we have to look at developers as a group that is responsible for a lot of the problems in Flushing, not necessarily Chinese people.
On that point, I think we also have to look at, in terms of the future of Flushing, we have to look at it that there's the local community that basically lives in the core area, but Flushing is sort of unique in the sense that when the same train stops there, and there's 20-some-odd buses that emanate from Flushing throughout Northeast Queens, South Queens. So part of the problem, or part of the trickiness of trying to figure out Flushing, is how do you deal with the people who live in the core area, but also all the people that transit through there on a daily basis. I mean, you know, citywide, it's the third most used intermodal transportation place. So I think that's part of the reason why it's so hard to get a handle on what to do with downtown Flushing. And again, you know, there are things that are happening in terms of, let's say, transportation. You know, for those who live in the neighborhood, you may have noticed that Main Street now has the stop, what they call it, the stop serve or bus service?
Yes.
The SBS, where it doesn't make all the stops, it's a special lane. You know, these are all iterations of attempts by the city to address some of the infrastructure issues, such as transportation. And it's not always immediately successful. And what I would like to say to that is that it's all part of a learning curve, I think, in many, many ways. There's a learning curve between the older population of Flushing, who is now more diminished, and then there's a learning curve on the hand, you know, on the part of the newcomers, and they have to learn about each other, what came before them, and the people who are coming. Because I've had conversations with people and not always happy. You know, things like, I can't go to an Asian supermarket and buy bread. Well, I think anyone who's been to an Asian supermarket knows that's ridiculous, you know, because there are some commonalities no matter who you are. You know, we all eat bread, we all drink milk. And that's the thing that I think is going to be really important for the future of Flushing and New York City, that while we are a changing population, demographically, age, you know, whatever, that basically down at the heart of all this, we all have the same needs and wants. A good place to work, a safe place to live, a place to work, a place to raise our children. So yes, we're talking about a lot of different issues which are probably the latest iteration in a neighborhood where the ethnic population has shifted, but this is something that's been going in this country forever, depending on what part of the country is in, you know, those kind of things. So that's what I'm saying. I think the future is before us. There are ways we can work on this, and you know, I think there's hope.
I think though that you've hit on, and we've all hit on actually, some of the reasons that this is both potentially so interesting, but also at some level so tricky. You know, it's easy to understand why people get upset when a community is being disinvested or losing population or burning down like the Bronx in the 70s or rising crime. But in neighborhoods sometimes when crime is going down and property values are going up and everyone wants to be there, there's still problems. And those problems may be hard to articulate in the sense that, okay, I like the fact that people want to be there and I like the fact that crime is down, but I don't like the fact that my corner diner that I used to get donuts in now speaks a language I don't understand and I can't read the first sign I see. And again, those problems are often exaggerated, but it's a sense of feeling at home. And do you lose that sense of feeling at home? And I think the unfortunate thing is that we too often, ethnicity becomes a way of articulating that. Or it's those people coming in. Because as Tarry and John both pointed out, you know, ethnicity can, both on the part of the ethnics and on the part of other people, become a code for missing other variations. People of different ages have different needs. People of different social classes have different needs. Poor people may have different needs than rich people. But when we're thinking of them in terms of ethnic groups, the Chinese versus the Koreans versus the old-timers, you know, we obscure a lot of those other differences in needs and conflicts under the grounds that those groups are monolithic. And of course, we know they're not. But if one of the problems in a place like this is how do we then start to understand that those needs are not monolithic and start perhaps to make necessarily alliances, but cross-cutting recognition of our needs, particularly in a place where investment is growing and population is growing. And once again, something just at risk of repeating myself, that requires a whole new set of thinking, because for a very long time, New Yorkers were thinking the other way around. How do we deal with a world in which investment is decreasing and population is going down? Now, if investment is increasing and population is going up, how do we sort that out in a way that doesn't say, oh, thank God you're here with money, come do whatever you want, which unfortunately is, you know, at least during some previous administrations, was kind of the default position. Anyway, why don't we open to the audience?
Hi, my name is Choe Lin from Taiwanese American Association of New York. I know you are all the developer. You want to develop the community for the economic reason on the waterfront especially. You missed the chance of the money or whatever for this time, had to wait or something. But I had to applaud to Councilman Peter Koo. He had a vision to look on the health aspect of his constituent. Because I know every time when I drive through the highway, when I take a subway, I will smell those kind of dirty smell because that is a dumping ground. And the water is dirty, the ground is dumped for all kinds of dirty things. You don't know what is buried underneath there. So we do have to dig out what is in there. Because if you have a have a house in there, people will get sick. There might be the cancer agent there. Maybe down 10, 20 years down the road, our children will get sick. You know, you never know. But you, I think Peter Koo is completely right. You have to clean up the area. It's worth the wait. So I need to clean up the area, and maybe you should look for some other direction at this time. I'm sorry I had to voice this voice. I really love that councilman, not because of him, but because he stands for the health purpose. Look on the long term rather than making money now. Thank you for the opportunity to speak.
If I can quickly respond, I think that question really exemplifies the lack of information regarding the city planning process, because what the Flushing West redevelopment plan would have done, which Peter Koo decided not to support, was allow city government officials to look at the health and look at remediation policies so that we can start cleaning up some of the pollution that you talked about. But because Peter Koo decided not to support it, that won't happen. Plus, the development will continue. There's gonna be housing, there's gonna be commercial development there, but now without any kind of community oversight and without the kind of infrastructure development that we need. So in fact, we lost not only an opportunity, but we contributed to the health problems in our community by not continuing with the Flushing West redevelopment plan.
Can I just say something? Because actually there is a study, or there should have been a study that was conducted on the industrial pollution along the Flushing waterfront. The Flushing Willits Point Corona Local Development Corporation received a state grant to do exactly that, to assess the conditions, the existing conditions of the Flushing waterfront, to identify what kinds of remediation would be necessary. Not necessarily to do the remediation, but to do that kind of study that Peter Koo was calling for. That money is out there, and the Flushing Willits Corona LDC, you know, received the money, and they were supposed to conduct a study, which I don't know if it's publicly available, but I understand that it has been completed. But they got $1.5 million to do it, and that was the largest state grant to a local development corporation to do that kind of brownfield, you know, assessment. It's from the state's brownfield opportunities area. And part of that grant also required community participation in, you know, kind of identifying concerns. As you mentioned, you said the smells, et cetera. So, you know, this kind of is tied into Flushing West, because I think that what I understand is the Flushing Willits Point Corona LDC, they did a study, but part of it involved a rezoning, and that's when the New York City Department of City Planning kind of, I think, received the remaining $800,000 to conduct this rezoning study. So there was concern that, you know, is the city acting on behalf of the community's interest or on the LDC's interest? And of course, you know, who sits on the local development corporation's board, but many of the property owners, you know, that own land along the waterfront that would love to have it rezoned from industrial use to commercial use, because that increases, you know, the property value as well as enables them, you know, to build more commercial and residential buildings, market rate.
Yeah, the grant that Tarry is referring to is for a specific site on the land side of the Flushing Creek. So city planning is in the process of completing the environmental assessment, which leads to the actual environmental cleanup down the road. They first have to identify what's happening over there and what the likelihood is, and from there come up with some sort of an action plan. With respect to the Flushing River, Flushing Creek, I forget how many years ago, but it must have been 20 years ago, where they built. One of the issues is that there's unfiltered combined storm water dumping into that whole section of the East River from Astoria over to Flushing. So there's a federal consent order from the EPA that requires the city to do ongoing cleanup of that, otherwise they face federal sanctions such as loss of federal dollars, aid dollars, that kind of thing. So the city has been consistently over the years trying to address all of that. And you know, all the waterways in New York City are not so easily cleaned up because of the industrial past. You know, shipping, I mentioned this before, Flushing, New York City was a shipping town, so all sorts of things would go in there because things were transported by water. And in doing all that kind of business, all kinds of things were dumped into the water, fell into the water, however. But anyway, where I'm going with this is that because New York City was dumping untreated water into the waterways, there's a federal consent order which led to the building of a holding tank that was supposed to channel some of the water until it could be treated before it was put into the waterway. And currently, because the waterways are jurisdictions based on different lines between the city, the state, and the feds, so there is an ongoing federal study that's going on, and you know they're trying to figure out how to finally clean up the water. And this is something that doesn't get done 10 years, 20 years, because this is like 40, you know, maybe 100 years in the making. And that's just something that is existing throughout the country, you know, more locally in New York State. This whole thing with cleaning up the PCBs from the General Electric plant in the Hudson River, that's been going on as long as I can remember. So yes, that issue is a very serious issue, particularly for Flushing. There's no easy solution, but it is something that is being looked at consistently and not as quickly as we all would like it to be, but it is being looked at.
I'm Jack Eichenbaum. I am the Queensborough historian that was so nicely referred to by Tarry and John Choe. And when I think of my relationship with both Tarry and John Choe, who I've known for a number of years, I think of them as people who are concerned with this community and not as Asians. So that is a great change from the way I first considered the people who started moving into the community that I was born in 1943, and now still live in. But people kind of look different, but it doesn't mean they can't meet your friends and that you can't work with them. It is delightful for me to know and work with you. I have a few comments to make. First, about that sleepy village.
I knew you were going to take it.
Flushing in the late 19th century, before it became part of the city, was not a sleepy village. It was a very progressive place. It had the first free public high school in New York, in what is now New York City, where people didn't have to pay for high school. Before that, you paid for high school. It also had three train lines running through it, not just the one to Port Washington that we have now, although at that time it only went as far as Great Neck, but it also had a line that went up to College Point in Whitestone, and it had a line that went from what is now the Queens Botanical Garden all the way through the Casino Park corridor, through Casino Park and all the way to Garden City, Long Island. Those railroad tracks have since been taken up, but this was an important rail center. And the most important railroad of all was the one that went not to Penn Station, because that hadn't been built yet, but to Long Island City, and that was a way that farmers from Long Island could ship their stuff to Long Island City, and the products could be taken from Long Island City to markets in Manhattan. So not a sleepy place. The 1913 date that you mentioned was not the date of the Long Island Railroad. That is the date that the Long Island Railroad went overhead in Main Street. But the railroads were here way before that, and Flushing did not become a metropolis until with the subway. And it's 1928. I won't quibble with you on that one.
Land in 27. Right.
So that's a historical view. I want to, as I am the historian, but I'm really trained as a geographer, and I want to take you into the future, because the future is what we're all concerned about, and the future is already happening. And what's happening is our youngsters, the kind of students that Tarry faces, the kind of young people that John has working as interns in his office, Greater Flushing Chamber of Commerce, which I am pleased to be a member of and to work with. I am living in the same apartment in Central Flushing going on 39 years. It's right around the corner from Flushing High School. 39 years ago, if you watch the kids come out of Flushing High School, they hung around in little clumps, just like the answer to the race question in the census. You'd see the Asian kids hanging around together, and you'd see the black kids hanging around together, and the white kids hanging around together, and the, who did I leave out? And the Latino kids hanging around together, just like answering the race question, which I, by the way, since 1970, when you ask me what my race is, I say human or rat, depending on my mood. Now, I still live in the same apartment, and I see them coming out of school, and I see them coming out not by race. They come out with their friends, and they hang around in little clumps where the people, and you look at them, and it's very heterogeneous, you see. People who look sort of Asian, and sort of white, and sort of black, and sort of Latino, they're the second and third generations. They're coming from mixed marriages. They're genetically mixed, and they're culturally mixed, and you see these kids, and we have hope, because we are in Queens raising a generation where racism is not going to be a terribly bad issue. We'll have other problems, like maybe ageism. I don't know if I'll love old people, but they're getting along with one another, and this borough is just amazing. And we keep using the words diversity, and we need a new metaphor, and I've got the metaphor for you. It's not diversity, it's an interwoven fabric of different cultures and ethnicities. It's no longer a little bit of these and a little bit of those. We're blending things together. Our culture is changing. Our food habits are changing. There are restaurants that offer all kinds of food from all kinds of places. And you look at these kids, and they're there already. And they're the ones that are going to be taking us to where we're going in the next 20 and 30 years. And we have to educate them right. As an educator, Tarry, I'm sure you know what I'm talking about.
One more question from the audience. Come on up. Sorry, the microphone won't stretch.
Thank you. I don't think I can have this chance to speak. I just have a very, very small thing to ask, okay, because I've been living in Flushing about 20, 30 years, and before, okay, I walked along the Kasinitz Boulevard, and it was nice, clean, but with the increase of the population, right now you walk on the street, you can see those little pieces of things on the street, you know, plastic bag, okay, you know, it's not big, it's small, but it's accumulated on the side of the street, make it look not so good. So I think could we increase the garbage, the number of the garbage can on, along the street? Depends on the people, you know, population, okay? If it's a very crowded street, so many people, you can think one day how many the little pieces of garbage they need to put in a garbage can. Okay, and it depends on the how many people on the street walking, and you know, and then you increase the garbage can and increase the shift to clean up the garbage can. That I think that will make us more comfortable and make Flushing more beautiful.
I think there's a need for continuing education on many, many, many levels. Some of the things I've heard today is that people are not necessarily aware of the public, the things that are going on around them, and one way that for that to get better is for everybody to be more civically involved, more involved with government, more involved with their organizations. And when I was younger, there used to be things like advertisements on TV, don't litter in the middle of the school, don't litter, don't cross in the middle of the street, and I think that's something that we need to maybe reinstate so that people know that this is your place, don't mess it up.
Yeah. Well, I just want to say that garbage bins are highly politicized in New York City. And
you got them on an area.
And I've had my run-ins with the Department of Sanitation. I want to just give a quick example. On Prince Street and 37th, there is a triangle called the Prince Street Triangle, and for 2 years, the businesses around that triangle were trying to get the Department of Sanitation to install garbage bins. And they came to us saying, what can the Flushing Chamber do to help? And so we tried to contact the department, got nowhere, got a big runaround. And so we worked with one of our members, Crown Container, to say, you know what, we'll just install our own garbage bins and see what happens. And as soon as we had a news conference and started to install the garbage bins, all of a sudden the Department of Sanitation wanted to install their own garbage bins. And they insisted, like, well, if we install the garbage bins, then you have to get businesses to take care of them, because we're not going to take care of them. Anyway, I think unless there's a squeaky wheel in New York City government, you're not going to get your needs addressed. And so again, I just want to emphasize that we have to come together as a community and to start working together across ethnic and religious lines to address some of these issues. Otherwise, the city government won't pay attention. Now, and if we're divided, we're never going to get any of the things that we need addressed.
I feel the need. I love the question, and I feel the need to make an obnoxiously sociological point. And that is that when people complain,
the streets are too dirty. Look at all this, the streets are.
And of course, you know, when in really crowded areas, the streets often are dirty. And when people say, it used to be the streets were nice, the streets were dirty, and these new people have come in, and now the streets are dirty. And almost immediately, and this is again the reason ethnicity is sometimes a problem, we start to say, well, there are more of population X, there are more of this kind of people here, and the streets got dirtier, therefore the people of population X are dirty. Without noting that, as you very rightly point out, there's a lot more people here, and therefore you need more garbage cans. It's not that hard to figure out. What ethnic group they belong to is kind of a secondary question. There are 30,000 more people here than there were 20 years ago in this very small, crowded area. You will need more garbage cans. But unfortunately, I think we naturally sort of try to define that as the nature of the population. And the thing, I guess, is politically the question, is how do you keep those kind of concerns at the forefront? You know, recognizing, yeah, different ethnic groups have different customs, different populations. How you have so many people from so many parts of the world living together is going to be tricky. There are going to be moments of cultural actual difference about the way things are done. That's going to require some work. But not having bits of paper on the street, that's not a cultural norm. I mean, you know, that's got to do with the fact that we simply have a lot more people here and we need more garbage cans. And sometimes those simple questions, I think, get buried in communities like this due to the fact that we are so often inclined to see things in terms of group difference.
Again, you know, this issue of equity, Flushing is the fourth largest commercial district in the city. You don't see garbage piled up in Midtown Manhattan, Downtown Manhattan, or Downtown Brooklyn. The city needs to treat Flushing, Queens just like they do these other large central business districts.
I'd like to thank our panelists from today. Let's give them all a warm round of applause. That's all of the time that we have for today, but we'll be hanging around for a little bit after the program, and I would encourage you to come and talk to any one of us. And there is an information outside about our program that's tomorrow that's in Mandarin, and then also general information about the Queen's Memory Program. So I welcome you to stop any of us and ask us questions. Thank you.